He wrote My Bondage and My Freedom when he was about 45 years old. And he describes in there in good detail the beginning of chapter two about his walking here from Tuckahoe with his grandmother. And he describes the plantation with the smokehouse and the craft house and the blacksmith and this and that and the other thing. And when Professor Leone from the University of Maryland decided that they would like to do archaeology here, they came and they used that schematic as their starting point, and they put shovel to ground and hit the blacksmith shop right away. To think about a kid age 6, 8 who waited 40 years, give or take, to write this down and to be able to describe it with sufficient accuracy that an archaeologist 150 years later could stick a shovel in the ground and hit it on the bullseye. That's a pretty remarkable thing. He was a helper for Aunt Katie. And Aunt Katie was the African-American cook who prepared meals for the people that lived on the plantation, for the enslaved and the freed African-Americans, not the Lloyd family. You know, you could sort of conjure up in your mind this authoritative woman, probably a large woman, who didn't take much guff off of anybody. And given that African-American society is much more matriarchal, she probably was the queen bee of the entire place. And it's fairly clear from Douglass's accounts that he was afraid of her. So this fast forward to 1881, which is, you know, 60 years almost after he was here as a boy. And at this point, he was living in his home, which is right outside Washington. Right. So he came back to the Eastern Shore and went to St. Michael's for the express purpose of forgiving, what's his name, Covey, who was the slave breaker that Douglass flattened. If you read the accounts, this guy was, slave breakers were not nice people. And, you know, he was beating the dickens out of poor Frederick, who by then was a strapping young fellow with, anyway, so Douglass had had enough of it one day. He turned around and just literally cold cocked him. And that's when he got sent to Baltimore. So he took it upon himself that since he was coming to St. Michael's, he might as well come to Wye House to
check it out.
I'd say to make a statement, bearing in mind that at this point in time, 1881, Douglass was clearly the best known African American in the entire country. I mean, you'd probably be hard pressed to find anybody who didn't know who he was. So he came here by boat from St. Michael's, maybe because it's easier to get here on a boat, but maybe because in the earlier days, the Lloyds came back and forth from Annapolis or Baltimore by boat. So maybe he wanted to say, you know, he wanted to be able to make the statement, you know, I'm as good as these people are. Right? So he comes to the dock down on the Lloyd's Creek, which is the Wye River, basically. And he is escorted up to the back of the house where my great-grandfather, Charles Howard Lloyd, greets him on the back steps. This is 1881. My great-grandfather was then about 22. So he's a pretty young guy. His father, the seventh Edward Lloyd, is, as it was put, I think, in the news accounts, was unavailable. So I think we all know exactly what that means. So they sat on chairs on the back porch and, according to the newspaper article, drank tea. Well, It's been long reported in this, my family, that there isn't any chance of that, because my grandmother and my great aunt both swore on Bibles that they had never saw their father drink tea in his entire life. So we think that it more likely it was, I like to say, it was they were having a mint julep. But apparently this was a very forthright conversation. They got along very well together. What's interesting is that the word got out, and this is probably in part the way, you know, politics then and much different is today. You know, if an important person's going somewhere, everybody and his brother knows they're coming before they get here. So according to newspaper accounts, there were hundreds of African Americans in out front of the house waiting to get a glimpse of Frederick Douglass. I like to emphasize the significance of Frederick Douglass coming and being allowed to venture into Wye House. I mean, and this is the height of Jim Crow, and that just wasn't done. But I can tell you that my great aunt, grandmother, and my mother would all say in absolutely that most people who haven't experienced it don't understand the relationship between some, the families of these former slaves, other just the citizens of Talbot County. And you know, when my mother was a little girl, the only people she played with were African Americans because there wasn't anybody else here. And I can tell you, she didn't have a prejudiced bone in her body. And from everything I could tell, neither did her grandfather. And I know her great aunt and grandmother did. I think what's the most important thing from my standpoint for our family is we don't hide this. You know, we don't pretend it didn't happen. And we opened up Wye House for archaeology, history studies, whatever, and for tours for people that are interested in understanding what happened. And we believe that it's our obligation, moral obligation, civic obligation, to allow better understanding of this stuff to occur. And it ain't gonna occur unless you have a chance to do work at Wye House.